The lakes are now home to more than 180 non-indigenous species, many native to rivers, lakes, and seas around the world. But one recent arrival has a different origin story. From Burlington, Ontario, TVO field reporter Jayan Jagannathan brings us the story.
A creature that sheds its skin, lays 500 eggs at a time, and can clone itself. Meet the marbled crayfish. They may not look scary, but these little crustaceans have wildlife experts in Ontario on high alert.
They're a big problem in Europe. They're spread all over. They're even in Israel and in Madagascar as well, in Africa.
Meet Premek Hammer. He's Ontario's leading expert on crayfish and dedicated over 40 years to researching them. In fact, he's known as Dr. Crayfish.
A marbled crayfish is a crayfish that originated in the pet trade, actually, in Germany. We think around the late 90s, we're not quite sure. There was a mutation, and this crayfish became parthenogenic, which means asexual, which means that it's all females, and those females are all fertile. So they'll lay fertile eggs, and those fertile eggs will all be females, and they will then continue laying eggs. They don't need any males.
Marbled crayfish range 10 to 12 centimeters in length, around 4 to 5 inches, and they look a lot like many of Ontario's native crayfish species.
One big difference between the crayfish that you see in our streams here and them is the marbled pattern. So they have this really characteristic marbled pattern on the side of the carapace and on top and even on the tail. But also their claws are proportionately smaller to the body. They have quite kind of dainty, longish claws.
As of 2022, marbled crayfish are listed as a prohibited species under Ontario's Invasive Species Act. This means they cannot be bought, sold, traded, or kept in a home aquarium. However, according to the Invading Species Awareness Program, that's still happening.
It was a very popular species in the aquarium trade, primarily due to the way that it reproduces. And so you had it in the aquarium trade both as a pet, but as well as food fish, or fish food, I should say. So because of the way it reproduces, you only need a few specimens. They reproduce, they create offspring. So you have a continuous supply of crayfishes to feed to, you know, your pet fishes, let's say.
Brooke Schreier is the assistant coordinator for Ontario's Invading Species Awareness Program. For over 30 years, the program has acted as a frontline defense against invasive species in Ontario.
So we're an education program that was started in 1992 as a partnership program between the Ontario Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry and the Ontario Federation of Anglers and Hunters. So back in the early 90s, we had the introduction of the invasive zebra mussel to Lake St. Clair. And at that point, the government said, we need to address this. We need to raise awareness in the province to try to mitigate its spread.
From zebra mussels to newer threats like the marbled crayfish, the group's work is needed more than ever.
Ontario is actually the most heavily invaded province out of any province in Canada, and that's primarily as a result of our history and the fact that we have the Great Lakes right there. So shipping was a big culprit for introducing invasive species, especially via the St. Lawrence. In Ontario today, we have about 445 invasive terrestrial species.
That includes bugs, plants, pathogens, and most recently, wild pigs. Wild pigs is a catch-all term that refers to escaped domestic pigs as well as wild boars, which were brought from Europe in the late 1980s to diversify Canada's livestock production. Recently, wild pigs have been causing havoc in Canada's prairie provinces, but luckily there are no established populations in Ontario, at least for now. If that changes, Brooke's team is sure to spot them.
They receive a trail camera, a spy point trail camera. They receive all the necessary things.
Every year we have 50 volunteers who sign up, who receive kits, which then they deploy. They bait a location. We tell them what to look for in determining a site, and then they'll deploy their cameras, they'll monitor those cameras, and then they'll make sure that they report any potential sightings to us.
When it comes to Ontario's waterways, Brooke says there are 185 non-native species. Of those, 10% are considered invasive, meaning they have extreme impacts on the environment and economy. While the impact of marbled crayfish has not been felt yet, Hammer and Schreier are worried about the potential harm to local habitats.
There'll be competition for resources. They also will eat aquatic plants. So they could, you know, damage the ecosystem. They'll eat snails, they'll eat insects. And so if they're increase in large numbers in water bodies, they can basically cut off the bottom of the food chain.
If they burrow en masse, that can lead to erosion, shoreline erosion, those types of infrastructural damages, particularly in urban environments.
This is ground zero of the marbled crayfish invasion, City View Park in Burlington, Ontario. These ponds are the first places in North America where these tiny creatures were found in the wild. Back in late 2021, someone snapped a photo of a crayfish and shared it to iNaturalist, a citizen science tool, in hopes of identifying it.
And in this case, the individual did not know what it was, had reported the photo. It went for a few months without us finding it until Dr. Premek Hammer brought it to our attention.
The following summer, I went to a World Crayfish Conference and I brought the picture with me, and they identified it positively as a marbled crayfish.
That same year, Hammer and Schreier conducted a search of the pond and set traps, but came up empty-handed. The team collected samples using environmental DNA technology to find them.
We do a lot of environmental DNA in our job, where what we essentially do, just to break it down to its nuts and bolts, is collect water samples, put them through filters, then take those filters, send them to Trent University, where Chris Wilson has his eDNA lab, and he's able to process those samples to determine whether or not the DNA of that particular species is in that water. So there are limitations with eDNA, because primarily what it's telling you is presence or absence. Is that species there? But if you do get a confirmed hit of DNA, you don't necessarily know what that specimen looks like. Right. Is it a dead specimen? Is it a living specimen? Is it a bird that ate some of it and then defecated? So there's no real way of knowing, but it's still a smoke alarm, and it's telling us that we need to keep looking.
Despite positive eDNA tests, it would be another summer before the team finally saw an actual crayfish. The group captured dozens of marbled crayfish at the site in the months that followed. However, wiping out these rapidly self-cloning crustaceans would need a tougher approach. Over the winter, city workers drained the ponds in an attempt to freeze out the invasive crayfish. It's believed they can survive temperatures as low as 4 degrees Celsius, but any colder, and they go dormant and painlessly freeze to death.
So luckily these ponds are self-contained. They're stormwater ponds, so they're not connected to any stream or anything. So that's one of the good things about this whole thing. By draining the ponds down to as low as possible, we were hoping that it would freeze the mud, and the crayfish, they burrow, they make burrows, so they can make shallow burrows and escape. That's how frogs and other things also survive our winters. And so we were hoping if we lower the water, it would freeze them and they would die.
The team has had good success so far, with dead crayfish carcasses littering the pond's edge to prove it. But warmer winter temperatures have been a challenge.
You need to hope that when you do drain those ponds, that one, you're able to drain them low enough that you're going to freeze those crayfish out of their burrows, but then also for a long enough period of time that they're actually exposed long enough to then cause, you know, death.
It's not clear how the marbled crayfish ended up in Burlington, but it's suspected that someone illegally owned one or more and released them into the storm ponds. Wildlife officials are aware that even though they are prohibited, the crayfish are still being sold and purchased in Ontario.
We're still seeing sales online, whether it's Facebook Marketplace or if it's places like Kijiji. Those are the areas where we're seeing those ads pop up. And each time we see one, what we're doing is our due diligence to make sure that we're contacting the authorities, the proper authorities, the Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry, to inform them of these sales that are going on that are in contravention to the Invasive Species Act.
The Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry says it's taking an education-first approach and have not laid any charges so far.
I think the level of knowledge around marbled crayfish is kind of 50-50. Some people know that it's a problem and unfortunately have continued to try to sell it, whereas others just don't know at all. And that's where, you know, organizations like mine come in, where we're trying to elevate that education and outreach component.
The team cannot be certain that the ponds in Burlington are the only place in the province where a population has been established. That's why Hammer and Schreier plan to work with conservation authorities along the Great Lakes to defend Ontario's shorelines from these alien creatures.